Hello there. It's Jake Kaminski here live. I'm going to be doing a rebuild of the Rinehart WAVE target. Completely from zero. So I'm going to talk a little bit to feed while people start to fill in. But I'm bearing with a little bit of inclement weather here. It's starting to rain a little bit on and off. Luckily, it's just kind of a light rain and I've got a hat covering the phone. So hopefully that'll protect it a bit. But anyway, I've got two different ones here. This is a prototype one that I've had for a few years. Actually, probably going on 4 or 5 years now. And then this one over here is the one I normally shoot on. It's a regulation size. You can see it's slightly bigger. The first prototype was too small. But this one here is a standard 52-inch square. Yes, it's a little uneven, but it's level to the ground. I have a little bit of a slope here on the property. So I'm going to go through this from top to bottom, kind of show you guys some features about it. And then, I'll, rebuild it and I'll show you why. But, so it's just your standard high density foam. How you going, Ben? I'll show you a couple features, I guess, with the phone here. Let me turn it around. Sorry, let me shake the camera a bit, turn it. But you can see here there's 5 main cores, one in the center and then one on each main corner. I've shot it quite a bit, as you can see. I've already replaced and swapped around one core. So you can see I already shot that one out and that one's starting to really be shot out. So I've had this for a few years. It's a little wet from being rained on. But, I've got it set up where I've shot some indoors rounds and things like that, which obviously is not optimal on this type of target. They have another one that's called the brick wall, which has, slats that are about 5 inches wide, run horizontally, easily to work. But, 716, I know, I haven't heard that zip area code in a while. And you can see it's well shot up. I've got a pile of rubber down on the bottom. I think I did the math. I've got somewhere about 1.5 years on this target, this core alone. Just poking out the back, not passing through yet. Man, I'm a little worn out in a couple areas that I wish I didn't wear out, but this is why I'm doing it live, so you guys can see the ins and outs of the actual target and actually get a feel for how it's built. But it's 15 inches thick. It is a beast of a target, so you can see how thick it is. And then it's held together by a ratchet strap. Now, the ratchet strap I had was not long enough, so I made an easy extension out of a nylon rope. Seems to be helping and holding just fine. It's on a standard stand that I've got it on for, a standard round feed a bale, something like that. But Bence, we'll get to that type of stuff, Q&A, off-topic stuff after we're done with the target. But for now, we'll stick with on-topic stuff here, the target or related to it, if that's cool. Because I'll definitely have time to cover that type of stuff later. But each core and the sides here and in their corners are held in by these tubes. They go through this main target and into this and help and poke into this section. So it actually holds it so it doesn't fall out or rotate. And you can see each mark here has an indentation for alignment purposes. This one's in backwards, so there is no line. So you get the holes oriented right. But so
that's kind of a basic layout of this target. A couple reasons why I really like it is obviously it really holds up. So there's a couple things out there that I feel like is important to discuss, especially directly related to shoulder injuries and tightness and pain in archers. And a lot of people complain of that, and I'm one of them. I don't complain of it anymore. I've learned to live with it, and actually I've learned to mitigate it and help correct it and solve it. But what my firm belief is, and by the way, before I get started, I see some people are starting to share and comment, and I really appreciate that. It gets it out to a lot more people, and this is why I do these videos, to bring you guys more information, and the more people see it, the more inclined I am to keep doing this and bringing up more and more topics. So I do appreciate every time when you guys share and like and comment on this and be involved, because it it expands the reach of everything. So I definitely appreciate that. But anyway, shoulder pain. So in archery, yeah, there's a lot of repetitive motion, one direction, one side, all the same, and there's a lot of tension that you're holding. If you're shooting a compound, you have a lot of tension here. If you're on recurve, you have a lot of tension back here. So there is has been studies in other sports, specifically baseball, that have studied the shock loads on the shoulder when the ball is released. And what happens is, if this is the socket and this is the head of the bone here, as they release the ball, it has a shock load and actually shudders back and forth and slams back and forth inside the joint, and actually causes a lot of capsule tightness as well as rotator cuff issues because of the repetitive slamming back and forth. All right, so with archery, there is some sort of shock load as you're at full draw. You're holding a lot of tension and then you break free, but you follow through. In my belief, what I think is more damaging to shooters is pulling arrows out of a target, especially if they're shooting blank bail, because they're pulling in an overhead position, and that really closes the subacromial space here, where a lot of the nerves and tendons and rotator cuffs and all sorts of muscles run through the shoulder inside of, in between your clavicle and the bone, and you know, all this whole area that basically it closes when you reach overhead like this. So my theory is, especially if you're pulling on targets that are really difficult to pull from, you are pulling a whole lot of tension, a whole lot of energy, and sometimes it's more than we're shooting in our bow weight, because there's tournaments that we go to, especially in the US, shooting on other targets, that we have four grown men on an arrow trying to pull an arrow out of the target, and sometimes we'll have to even take the target button, put it on the ground, and pull it out like Excalibur, because we can't even break them out of the targets. So my theory is that as we're pulling really hard to get arrows out of the target, we're pulling, and all of a sudden it breaks free, and then we have to decelerate our arm. Because again, when the ball is being thrown, it's not the act of throwing, it's when the ball is let go, it's decelerating the arm and rotating that makes the impact inside the shoulder, the shock loads. So that's what I think is happening when you're pulling arrows. You're pulling really hard, and then all of a sudden it breaks free, and you have to slow down and stop your shoulder. Now, when we're shooting, it's different. Yes, we're letting go, but we're not actively decelerating our arm. We're just finishing follow through until we can't move anymore, and then our body's limitation stops the motion. It's not like a baseball player throws the ball and lets their arm slap them in their side. They stop their arm from hitting them. Same thing when we're pulling. I stop the arrow so I don't stab somebody behind me who's too close or something like that. So this is the reason why I choose this target. This target is super easy to pull from. It lasts really, really long. There is some targets out there that are easy to pull from, but it's a little bit different than this one. They're easy to pull from, but they wear out super fast. This one lasts forever. It is really thick, it's really heavy, but like I said, I've probably got 170 to 200,000 shots on that core alone before I've even had to replace it. And I don't have to replace it, I'm just starting to tear up the target face a little bit more than I want to. Because the arrows flap around when they hit in the target. But then also, you know, I have the opportunity to share with you guys what I'm doing, so I wanted to do this and get it out there. But so anyway, why is it different than other targets that are easier to pull from? Now, the ones that are easy to pull from, it's difficult to pull the, if the arrow is, you know, 6-8 inches into the target, it's easy to pull the arrow out of the target, but it has drag for the full 6-8 inches. On this, once you get the arrow started, it just slides right out. It just pops right out, and it heals, with the exception of when you're shooting really big fat arrows, like the holes over here and there. But you know, big fat arrows, when I'm shooting and literally putting the same target face up on the other worn out target face, so the holes are perfectly centered on everything, you know, wear happens. But yeah, so lasts a super long time, and I think it really helps prevent injury. And this is why I think it's really important, and why I'm really excited now that I have a Rhino Brute, which is a 16 inch by 16 inch square target that has actually a replaceable core in it as well. So I can replace those easy. I'll shoot it at blank bail, especially when I'm shooting overhead and I'm pulling arrows out like that. It'll help my shoulder a little bit more. Like I said, it won't shock load as much as a lot of the other targets out there. So anyway, I think they call it the Wave because the lines here have a wave to them, or World Archery, you know, WA. Yeah, don't know. But any questions so far on my idea and theory on shoulder injuries and shock loading and decelerating and things like that, or maybe how easy it is to pull or anything like that. I've shot compound at it, recurve at it, I've shot broadheads into it. I have, there's a couple of holes that I could show you with the broadheads, but I've shot everything into it, big fat arrows, small arrows, carbon fat arrows, aluminum fat arrows, everything. And the hardest thing that it is to pull out of, which is not that hard in relation to a lot of other targets, but in the scale of hardness easiest, is a fat carbon arrow out of a compound. And it has, you know, it's got a little bit of resistance to start, but it's not nearly like other targets. And like I said, once you get it moving that first quarter inch, it just slides right out. So once it pops, it moves. It's not a drag having to pull it out the whole way like in a lot of the other ones. Typical price of the target. I should have looked this up. I think this is something I wanted to cover, and I'm glad that I can share this with you guys and maybe get some excitement out there. But I think they're in the $1,700 range to $2,200 range, give or take. But the good thing about that is it'll last you a lifetime. You can buy a core for $75, one of the round pieces, $75 if you ever run out of them. So that's great. But that one has been sitting in the Florida sun with no cover. I do not cover it on purpose to really get it as worn and heated and melted as possible. And it's fine after 5 years. It breaks down into four sections, so they just ship them UPS ground. They don't have to put them on a pallet. You don't have to pay $250 to have them shipped on a semi and have to be at home when they're delivered. They come in a UPS box, nothing special. So that saves a lot on shipping, and it's a lot easier to get, and it's not a hassle. You don't have to have a business address, a loading dock, things like that. And when does my book come out? We're pretty much done again. I've said this already, but we're doing it the beginning. It'll be by the end of quarter one. Looking, hopefully, and it should happen, for sale at Arizona Cup or just before. So that's the plan. But use the whole body to pull the arrow, not just the arms and shoulders. That works if you have a really heavy target like this and you're at full extension and you just pull back, but still, you're gonna have to, there's lots of repetitive pulling of the arrow to get it out of the target. And pulling the arrow, I mean, use your whole body. Sure, I'm using my whole body like I pull start a lawnmower. I use my whole body to pull back, not just pulling like this. But it definitely, like I said, there's still a shock load. There's still deceleration that you have to do, and that's what causes some injuries, and I think is common in this sport. So could I also change out one of the four main sections in addition to the five cores? Yeah, I would assume they have a replacement for just this piece. I'm sure if you called them up and special ordered it or asked for it, you could get it, no problem. But I know the cores, you can order them at Lancaster, so you don't even have to go through them. But the main thing, I would assume so. So if that's about all the questions we've got on that stage so far, I'll start pulling it apart, and then we'll get more into the features and show you what we're at. I'll show you what I've gotten into and how rough it is, because I've shot it a lot. So just pull the ratchet strap off. Now this ratchet strap's been on for a few years in the sun and in the heat, so it's a little sticky. We'll see what kind of creatures we'll find in the target. I see scorpions. Didn't know Florida had scorpions until I moved here, but I see them all the time hidden in these targets. Overall size is 52 inch square by 15 inches thick. Probably weighs 250 pounds. It's heavy, but it's worth its weight in gold, in my opinion. I know, Mike, it's a pretty sweet looking target, right? But anyway, checking for scorpions. So, each one, I'll show you up close. Each one has a little keyway in the main sections. And then in the center core, there's these little blocks. And on each core, and I'll get into it once I start pulling it apart. But there's a keyway that inserts into each one. There's a receiving on this end, and there's a female on this end and a male on this end. Same in here. Female here, male here. So they all insert into each other, and they're all universal, so you don't have to, when you call them up, if you were to want a replacement piece, is to just, the target model is in the description. It's called the Rinehart Targets WAVE, W-A-V-E.
So it's just R-I-N-E targets, Rinehart targets. Anyway, they're universal. So this top left is the top right is the low left. So they're all the same pieces. So if you were to, and they did offer, and I'm assuming, Mike, they probably would sell you just one of the main sections as a replacement if you had to. Like, mine's a little worn out here, but it's fine. Yeah, they're all universal, which is cool. So I'm not gonna, I'm gonna pull this one down because I'm gonna replace the main core with this core. And then I'll just tilt this one back. So, a little worn out, lots of stuff falling out of it. You can see how shot up this thing is, just starting to protrude in the back. But anyway, you can see there's the four little block sections that I said where the in here has these block sections or protrusions. Here's the receiving end of it. And then, as I mentioned before, and I'll show you in depth once I get to it, but these holes here are for plastic tubes that insert through the side of the main keys themselves. So do I flip the target over to shoot from the backside? No, I do not, because I did on the core that's in this one here. I flipped it over and started shooting it, and that's when I had my first pass through. After probably around 20 months with two people shooting on it full time, I had my first pass through on this target. So that's a long time and a lot of arrow. I'm probably around that core is probably around the 300,000 arrow mark before I had one pass through. In one, you know, whatever size core this is, probably 13-14 inch core, something like that. So I don't shoot it from the backside. I am gonna flip it around and stick it in the upper section like this, so at least it looks solid, and it'll stop arrows for a while, but that way there won't be a gaping hole in it. So yeah, so it's pretty heavily shot up, and I might flip over the keyway or the whole target, I don't know. The outer edge is starting to get a little bit of damage just from shooting eights and stuff. Yes, it happens, and I don't want eights, but it happens. I don't think I'm gonna flip it around though. The whole thing is so heavy, and I don't really need to right now. Yeah, I've shot compounds into this, Chris. I've shot broadheads into it too. There's a couple of broadhead holes down here. Yeah, I shot a lot of different stuff into this target, so there you go. Mike's got the number. So they do sell the quadrants. He's got part numbers for us here. It's part number 19021 for a core, it looks like, and part number 19030 for the quadrant. How does it handle shooting wet? Never had a pass-through. Arrows pull out super easy. Well, I had one pass-through, remember, when I flipped the core around after 300,000 arrows, but that doesn't work, so... I don't notice that I have any more penetration at all in the wet at all. So, grab some water. Any questions yet before I get going? No. All right. Well, again, I appreciate everybody being here. And before I move forward, like I said, the share and like the post and comment and things like that, it gets more and more people exposed. And I really appreciate it when you guys do that. It really helps me out and helps reach, broaden my reach and get a lot more people involved and excited. So anytime you guys want to or see these videos and you want more to happen, like and share and things like that, it really helps me out. So this side is where they injection molded it here in their big mold. And then here's the tubes, and I'm gonna have to go get some needle nose pliers, but the tubes are right in here. Yeah, I'll be right back. Let me run and go get it really quick. It'll be like 2 seconds. All right, actually, let me turn the camera around so I can see you guys if you have any questions as I'm going. Let's see. Chris, you could probably buy however many you want, as Mike just said, but depends on what you're using it for. Like I said, they've got a... they've got a brick wall that is, I think it's 5-inch sections that are that go horizontal strips if you're going to shoot in a lot of like a lot of indoor stuff or fields or whatever. But yeah, anyway, needle nose pliers, and then here's the tube that goes through the core and holds it inside of the key sections. And this is something, Mike, that I talked to you guys at ATA about. From what I understand, Rinehart's most expense to build the targets is the actual foam. And I think we should make a Wave light that would be more consumer friendly. I know this is totally marketed for the shop owners or the pro shops or the ranges, because they last forever and a day. But I think making these quadrant sections without a core and half the thickness, and then leaving the main center core 15 inches thick, would reduce the amount of foam by almost half, therefore almost the price by half. Wouldn't affect shipping that much, but I think if you guys out there, Mike, I talked to, I'm blanking on her name, there, and she's like, yeah, that's exactly what we want to do. So, or that sounds very exciting. She hadn't thought about it, so talk to her about it. And if you guys as consumers out there are excited and want that to happen, I would encourage you to go to the Rinehart page, comment them. Yeah, Tanya, my bad. Go over there and tell them that you want a Rinehart Wave light, L-I-T-E, or a light version or something like that. It'll reduce the price by half, and I think everybody, everybody that shoots archery, compared to some of the other targets that are out there, it would actually be cost worthy that way, especially if you're ordering one new, because then you don't have to pay $300 some on shipping to have it brought to you on a semi. So, again, it goes in a box in UPS and it just gets shipped that way. So anyway, pulled the tubes out. Now we're going to kick out the cord. I remember this being sticky before from just sitting in the heat. Let me make sure there's nothing else. Nope. I think I had to do this, wedge my needle nose down in it to just pop it free. Because again, like I said, this thing has been sitting in the sun for, this one's three or four years old, uncovered. There we go, I hear it breaking the seal. Oh, it's welded itself in there. Yeah, I figured. So that's why I'm popping it free. Might have to go get a sledgehammer. There we go. So here's a fresh core, basically. Plans available for a stand? I suppose I could show you my stand. It's really easy. I just basically found somebody's stand on how to build it or something like that. I don't remember. And I just built it and it worked fine. Anyway, here's a good core, pretty fresh. Again, here's those locking sections and the holes. So no problems at all.
I'm gonna put it where the brand new side is facing out. Yeah, I'll give you a little bit of a view. Zach's, what you're referring to is Zach's stand. But that's, you know, the core, not too torn up from arrows dropping in from the top and anything like that, so that's pretty good. Maybe Josh, you're referring to the stands they use at the training center. I didn't know it was his design, but it's made out of metal, so a lot of people don't have the ability to weld, or at least don't know how to weld. I just made mine out of, I think it's pressure treated 2x4, and it's holding this thing up just fine. I've had it for a few years, like I said. So anyway, this is the side that gets shot. If I flip it, that won't work. I'd have to flip the whole target, so I'm just gonna keep leaving that out. But I'm gonna put the unshot side back in, facing forward. I'm gonna kinda put the protrusion back in. That's better. Anyway, and then I gotta look for the keyway line, which is facing down on the other side, so I'm gonna put it down in order to have the tubes insert in. The line is there, but it's pretty well shot up over here, so I'm just gonna point it down. Take the tubes. Oh, I nailed it. So it's a little shot up. That's why it's hard to get the tube in right away. But there you go. So that's swapped now to where this will hold, and I'll put it back up there. I can't imagine that's the case, Ian. If it is, contact the retailer that you bought them from, or look at my video that I did, my live video on how to set it up, and maybe something's a little off. I don't know if you did the limb alignment right with stabilizers the way I showed to use as alignment, because if I don't, I think they're twisted too. But once I do, then they look perfectly straight. So yeah, here's the core that I'm gonna use as a replacement, and instead of putting the slightly shot up side forward, I'm gonna put the brand new side forward. And then I just line up the blocks down here with the keyways on this. Pretty straightforward. Drop that side down. Lock them in, and then it'll draw up when I tighten the ratchet strap. And again, the ratchet strap that I had wasn't long enough, so I just made a little extension with some nylon rope, and it's working no problem. Take two arrow down there. Yeah. It only works if the limbs are aligned. Like I said, I'd go back to that and start there.
Try to pull it down a little bit more on the top. There. That's it. Easy. Super simple. Yeah, Chris, that's all a ratchet strap is needed. You can see on this one here, same deal. This ratchet strap was long enough, but again, this is a prototype target. But they do make ratchet straps that are long enough. That work just fine. This one's been out in the sun for 7 years, or 5 years, so you can see it's a little faded. But Oliver, are you asking if I get grooves in the rest itself from the arrows? No. Would you if you were a bare bow? Yes. Because of a downward load on the rest. The arrow's just gliding over it and moving out of the way. The reason that the plunger wears is because the arrow bends and pushes a lot of pressure into the plunger as it's going by. So anyway, any questions on the wave before we go into off-topic stuff? Because we'll cover that. We'll do some Q&A as well. But yeah, love it. It's back together. And now I've got 3 cores left, so I've got at least another probably 4 to 5 years on this target before I need a core to order. But I'm really happy with it. No, I don't get grooves in my arrows from the rest. I should have known that's what you were asking, but no, I do not get grooves in my arrows from the rest because, again, there's not a lot of downward pressure. Now, if you had too low of a knocking point, the arrow basically gets pushed down and then it ramps off the rest. And yeah, maybe you would get wear either on the rest or the arrows. So, I'll take the target back up. Like I said, I'm open to questions now on anything, any topic. I'm happy you guys joined me for the live building of rebuilding of the Rinehart WAVE with me. Again, it's R-I-N-E-H-A-R-T, Rinehart, and targets WAVE. If you are interested in the WAVE Lite, as I suggested, thanks Mike, I appreciate it. If you are interested, mention that I sent you over to their page and say, you know, we really want to get this target, get our hands on it. I'm not sure, Stefan, if they are available in the UK. I'm assuming it's Stefan and not Steven over there. I would assume they are. I don't know what distributor they would be available through. I know that Lancaster Archery Supply has them here. So I'm assuming that you could probably order and have it shipped overseas from there. Worse comes to worse. Rinehart may sell them direct. But yeah, like I said, if you're interested in the Wave Lite, head over to their page. Tell them I suggested it to you guys because I think it'd be worth it. Again, injury prevention and longevity. These things last forever and a day. Yeah, the target's this big because I shoot from 70 meters or 77 yards, which is back by the house. But yeah, this is the target we shoot at the Olympics at the Olympic distance. Okay, what's Ben's? We got, so my veins are damaging a bit by the rest of the plunger button. What do I think? They're spider veins. I'm going to assume either you don't have them rotated right or you don't have the tune right. Because if the tune's not right, the arrows won't bend enough away from the rest as they go by, or they're not rotated correctly. So I would play with rotation. And if you have any doubts that you are making contact, you can use foot powder spray. So like a foot drying powder spray. I suggest that because it's not sticky, but it's in an aerosol, so you can spray it really easily, and it's white. It sticks on the bow. It'll wipe off when you're done with it, but you can shoot and then you can see if the vein is making any contact anywhere on your bow and get a good idea there. Curtis, I can assume that I've shot somewhere in the 300,000 arrow range in on this core that was in the upper right hand corner that I shot face on, and I guarantee it could have lasted a couple more months had I not flipped it around to see. Once I flipped it around within a day, I was already passing through. Just because it was pushing the material out the back instead of jamming it against the solidness in the back of the target itself. Yeah. Compound archery in Olympics 2024. If LA gets the bid, yes, it will be.
as a provisional sport, not solid and not forever. There's a chance that it will happen if LA gets the bid. Other than that, I'm going to say probably never. Unfortunately, it's just the way the people that run the organizations choose it to be. So, all right, Steven, thanks. How many American whitetails worth you think I get from one wave? Well, I could say that there would be none that would be worth it just because of the health of my shoulder, for sure. If I knew what I know now about shoulders and targets, I would have homemade one of these things with some of their 3D foam long before I was a resident athlete and shot hundreds of thousands of arrows in a year. But as far as durability wise, I can only speak from experience. I've had some of those that are really good and really easy to pull from, and they last a fair amount of time. And then I've also had some that literally the first arrow will pass through. And then I've had it where 4 grown men can't pull an arrow out of a target, especially if it's raining, it's impossible. Now, why is that? Is that's because the manufacturing of those, it's a byproduct of something in the airplane industry. So they take foam and they roll it up on a mandrel and they make targets, which it's great. I mean, it's a good cost-effective target to buy as the target, but then you're shipping, because it's so large, you can't ship it through UPS. You got to pay a semi to come to your house, which again, like I said, it's between $250 and $300 for delivery. You have to be home and you have to accept it off of there. And it's a hassle, whereas this, they just come in a UPS box, and I'm really happy with the way that mine have shown up. I never had any issues. The box is held up well, and you literally throw it together in a matter of minutes. It's really not that hard. So I think, depending on the target itself, in my experience, I would say 10. Between 5 and 10 cores before I ran out of this one, or more. It really depends on the shooter, the type of bow, the arrow, things like that. So, yeah, Steve, they are definitely on the pricier range, like I said, but they last forever in a day. You're not going to have to buy multiple cores, cut them, glue them, heat them, melt them. You literally just pop them in and out like I showed you, super easy and simple. But I don't, I can't put a value on that target because it is such a pleasure to shoot on. And, I have by far reduced my shoulder strain, from shooting into it. And a large part of the reason I even have shoulder issues is because I was pulling from another target, especially when I had the target elevated for blank bail to simulate 70 meters, which is a great idea. But I did make a couple of stands where we could stand up on the target and pull arrows from chest height, just we are shooting on these on the ground. So if you do shoot at an elevation, I would suggest standing, make a footstool or stand on a footstool so it's pulling at a decent height, so you're not closing the subacromial space and really putting impingement issues on your shoulder, because that's my type of problem with my shoulder. So doing it that way, I think, will help solve that. Yeah, I'm assuming it'll be at 50 meters if LA gets the bid, just like that. Do I shoot 90? I don't shoot 90 anymore because it's not at World Championships, and I don't bother with state championships or anything like that. I just don't. Let's see, the TFT and NS. I'm gonna, Ian, could you send me some pictures of the bow itself? And I'll get a kind of an idea of where it is. And did you run just one stabilizer and make sure that one stabilizer is straight? Because if you didn't, that'll throw everything off. 13-year-old son changing from compound to recurve. Good idea. It's gonna teach you, compound taught you a lot of things to move into recurve. One of those things is never stop pulling. You're always pulling against the wall with a recurve. There, you don't wait, don't stop, don't sit there and do nothing. You really got to keep moving the whole time. The shoulder, my right shoulder. So the arrow that pulls the arrows mostly, I'm right-handed. Tried doing it left-handed, doesn't work. And even I've had forearm issues, specifically at Arizona Cup. Pretty much every year at Arizona Cup, because I'm grabbing onto an arrow in this position, which is flexing this side of the forearm, and trying to grab and pull. And again, like I said, probably putting 70, 80 pounds of force on an arrow to break it free from a target, not good. Yeah, again, Steven and everybody, if you're interested, like I said about the light version of this target, head over to their page, suggest it, and mention that you saw it on this Facebook Live, because I think it would be great. And like I said, they told me that their price on targets is almost 100% based off just the volume of foam. So if we cut it in half, that means the price is half. And I'm pretty sure a lot more people would be more inclined as a consumer to buy it. This is essentially the best range target you could ever get. If somebody owns a range, you're not gonna have to buy targets again. And I can tell you the people that have bought them for ranges are very, very happy with the quality and the performance of these targets. And you're definitely cannot be disappointed for sure. So we'll go for another minute or two on questions, and then we'll end it here. But vibration of your sight. What kind of sight do you have? I'm not sure what type of vibration you're meaning like residual noise vibration. What's up, Bronson? But anyway, seeing how there's no more questions, I'm gonna end it here. If they fill in before we cut the video off, I'll do my best to answer them. But again, I appreciate it. Thank you everybody for coming in, saying hi, being involved, sharing the video, liking the video, commenting. Again, all those things get it out to more people. And the more people that see it, the more interested and more inclined I am to doing these type of things. I really like sharing information, but if it's not going out to anybody, I would rather spend my time a little bit differently, maybe more wisely, who knows, or unwisely, I'm not sure. But the more people that see it, that's why I'm excited about doing these things. When more people see it, I'm more inclined to do this more often. So again, this is going to be on Facebook forever. You'll be able to see it and go back and see it, as well as all of my Facebook lives. And here going forward, I am going to be uploading it on YouTube. It'll probably be up within 24 to 48 hours. We'll move forward. The book will be available on Amazon. It's going to be available at Lancaster Archery and a lot of other places as well. So it will be available in many different places on the internet for sure. I'll be selling them on my website probably as well. And then I could have some with me at some tournaments if I had some heads up on people before. We could save on some shipping and I could sell them direct to you as well. So no, Oliver, I've not tried the powder weight. I'm kind of excited about it. I'd like to try it, or something along those lines. It's a neat idea. But dampers, usually I never use them, but right now I'm using some Doinker, an A-bomb up front with 5/16 24 thread, so the big one, and the Quadraflex ones on the V-bar, which were from the Quadraflex stabilizers. But I'm shooting the AAE hot rods. We just don't have a damper for those yet, so... I appreciate everybody sticking around and being here. And again, like I've said, I will be posting this on YouTube and it'll be on Facebook forever. I really appreciate everybody standing out here and dealing with me having to run away and get some pliers. And I appreciate it. My cat's climbing a tree. Anyway, I wanted to thank all my sponsors for supporting me. Without them, I wouldn't be able to do this. Or at least have gotten so much experience and traveled the world to see it and appreciate that I am an American so much. But I'd like to thank them. Win and Win, Easton, Trueball Excel, Lancaster, AAE, Rinehart, Leupold, Acubow, there's all Wilderness Athlete. If there's anybody I forgot, I apologize. I won't forget you on other future videos. So I appreciate it. Thank you so much, guys. Take care and have a good rest of the day.